All right, everyone, please take your seats. We are going to start with tonight's event. Good evening. I would like to welcome all of you to tonight's event. My name is Negar Jadidi, and I am the founder and chairwoman of the Young Americans for Freedom chapter here at UNCG. I would like to address some housekeeping rules before we begin. We are aware that there are many of you here who disagree with our speaker tonight, and we are excited that you are here, but no disruption of any kind will be tolerated. Disruptors will be escorted out by the police immediately. We will have a Q&A portion, and we encourage you to ask challenging but respectful questions. Now, I would like to thank some very special people. This event is part of the Fred and Lynda Allen Lecture Series, and their generosity makes it possible for lectures like this to happen all around the country. Thank you to Young America's Foundation for sponsoring this lecture, the phenomenal YAF staff for their work, the UNCG administration, and local supporters who believe in us and our chapter. A big thank you to my executive board and my lovely chapter members for their help and support. Last but not least, a huge thank you to the leftists who, despite their efforts to kick us off campus, gave us free publicity and helped bring Ben Shapiro to UNCG. Our YAF chapter was founded in the fall of 2020 during the peak of COVID. Despite many challenges and hurdles, the chapter has grown immensely over the past 2 years. We meet about every 2 weeks and we host initiatives such as the 9/11 Never Forget Project, Freedom Week, and the Pro-Life Timeline Project. If you would like to join our chapter or have any questions, please email us at uncgyaf@gmail.com. I think I can speak on behalf of my chapter when I say that we are so honored and excited that Mr. Shapiro is here. He is the co-founder and editor emeritus of the Daily Wire and host of the Ben Shapiro Show, the largest and fastest growing conservative podcast and radio show in the nation. Shapiro is the author of 8 nonfiction books, including the 2021 New York Times bestseller, The Authoritarian Moment, How the Left Weaponized America's Institutions Against Dissent. Shapiro became a nationally syndicated columnist at age 17 and is now one of the most requested speakers on college campuses across the country, despite facing violent opposition by protesters. He graduated UCLA with a Bachelor in Political Science and then Harvard Law School in 2007. Please stand and join me in welcoming Ben Shapiro.
Thank you so much. It's great to be here. Well, thank you all. Thank you so much for coming. You guys are awesome. Well, hey, it's great to see all of you. Thank you so much for coming out. I want to first say thank you to Fred and Lynda Allen for sponsoring this lecture and for Young America's Foundation for making it happen, to the UNCG group that made this happen by apparently just posting a flyer that said men cannot become women. Which, until 5 seconds ago, I thought that men cannot become women was a pretty uncontroversial statement. But apparently it's so controversial that the UNCG administration had to actually sponsor like a full comfort event of some sort to make people feel better about the fact that somebody had told them the same thing that everyone tells a small child before they actually know how to get out of diapers. So, first of all, I'm glad that you're here. I'm glad to see you here and not at the Celebrating Queer event across the street. I was glad to see that they have a live DJ and free food sponsored by a bunch of groups, including the Campus Activities and Programs, No Labels, the Office of Intercultural Engagement, the Dean of Students' Office, the Campus Violence Response Center, which is weird. I mean, I don't feel that violent. The Counseling Center, and the Spartan Open Pantry. I mean, frankly, I think that I deserve a lot of credit for getting free food and a live DJ for these folks. So, so never say that I've never done anything for the LGBTQ plus minus divided by sign percentage sign ampersand tilde community. So, in the past few years, you've heard a lot of statements that sound like absolute gobbledygook. And if somebody from with a time machine from, say, I don't know, 5 years ago, moved forward about 5 years and heard these statements, they would think that they were absolute gobbledygook. You've heard that some men have vaginas and that some women have penises. And you've heard of pregnant men and men who chest feed and women who have prostate problems. You've heard that we shouldn't raise boys as boys and girls as girls because we can't actually be sure that kids have the sex, quote unquote, assigned to them at birth, which is an interesting phrase. You've heard that some people are men in women's bodies or women in men's bodies or agender widgets in the bodies of men or women as interpreted through the lesbian dance theory contingent's take on life. You've heard that if you're a man, this is my favorite one, you hear this one increasingly these days, if you're a man and you only want to have sex with biological women, this might actually make you gay, because after all, some women are in fact men and some men are in fact women. So if a man comes to you and says, I wish to have sex with you and I am a woman, and you don't want to have sex with that because that person's a man, this might make you actually a transphobe and or gay because you won't have sex with a man. So we've now reached the point in logic where if you're a straight man but you won't have sex with a man who identifies as a woman, you're actually gay. All of this is totally insane, of course. So why don't we begin with the basics? What is biological sex? Now, folks on the left have had a really tough time with this question. If you ask them, what is a woman or what is a man? They have a very difficult time answering this question, as my colleague Matt Walsh has pointed out. No one on the left can seem to answer this question, including the current Supreme Court confirmed justice, who literally said that because she is not a biologist, she does not know what a woman is, which means that it's not all that historic for her to be the first black woman on the Supreme Court, since the latter half of that designation doesn't have any meaning. She's the first black blank, but she's not the first black blank because we've had a couple of black Supreme Court justices before. So she's the first black genderless widget who may in fact be a woman, but she can't define it because she's not a biologist. However, it turns out that there are in fact biological definitions of womanhood, and they have been true for literally all of time, because all of human propagation depends on the distinctions between male and female, and pretending otherwise does not change those underlying facts. Sex is defined in all mammals, all of them, as the organization of an animal based on its capacity to reproduce. Males and females reproduce with one another in the human species. I know this is very difficult for some folks to understand, but only males and females together can make babies. The genetic material that comes from a male and the genetic material that comes from a female, that is what makes the baby. I have to give this speech to college students now. This used to be for like fourth grade biology. The simple reality is that the human species is sexually dimorphic. Sex is binary. We come in two brands, male and female. Those are all the brands. Typically, those who have XY chromosomes are male, and those who have XX chromosomes are female. The only reason I say typically is because chromosomes aren't the final definition of sex. Deborah So, a PhD in sexual neuroscience, writes, quote, contrary to what is commonly believed, sex is defined not by chromosomes or our genitals or hormonal profiles, but by gametes, which are mature reproductive cells. There are only two types of gametes, small ones called sperm that are produced by males, and large ones called eggs that are produced by females. Sex is therefore binary. It is not a spectrum. Now, males and females differ in a number of ways. A lot of ways. Biologically inherent, and that's not a bad thing. I don't know when this became a bad thing, but it turns out one of the most wonderful things about being human is the fact that there are these two separate sides of the human species, male and female. Males and females differ in size, shape, fat distribution, musculature, and aspects of brain function. As Diane Halpern, author of the book Sex Differences in Cognitive Ability, writes, quote, the literature on sex differences in cognitive abilities is filled with inconsistent findings, contradictory theories, and emotional claims that are unsupported by research. But despite all the noise in the data, clear and consistent messages can be heard. There are real, and in some cases sizable, sex differences with respect to cognitive abilities. Socialization practices are undoubtedly important, but there is also good evidence that biological sex differences play a role in establishing and maintaining cognitive sex differences. As neuroscientist Steven Pinker says, quote, differences between the sexes are part of the human condition. Leah Thomas, for all the talk differently, is still a dude racing against ladies, and this makes a difference when you get in the pool. Now, there are, of course, people who have anomalous genetic conditions. Conditions like Klinefelter syndrome, in which a person has two X chromosomes and a Y chromosome, and in whom breast development looks female while male genitalia are present, or a mutation in the SRY gene, which is carried on the Y chromosome, which could end in development of female genitalia despite the presence of XY chromosomes. Overall, disorders of sexual development affect about one in every 5,000 births. Typically, treatment of those with so-called DSDs, disorders of sexual development, begin with determining the causes of the disorder. But these folks do not represent a quote-unquote third sex. They are either male or they are female, and they have a disorder in development. The presence of abnormal development in males or females does not mean that sexual dimorphism does not exist or that sex exists on a spectrum. To suggest otherwise is really stupid. This is the same thing as saying that because one child every few thousand is born with three toes, this means the number of toes in a human being is a spectrum. Or that a person with three toes might be a sloth human. A human being with a genetic condition is a human being with a genetic condition, not a new sex or a member of the opposite sex. That's not how that works. Again, all reproduction is rooted in the presence of sexual dimorphism. To pretend otherwise is just biologically nonsensical. And to define sex in any other way is also nonsensical. That's why, to end a conversation on transgenderism, just ask for that simple, non-self-referential answer. What is a woman? Define man or woman. And what you'll find is that people have a difficult time. They'll say, whoever believes they are a woman is a woman. You can't define a term by reference to the term itself. That is not a way that you define terms in the English language or any other language. If I ask you to define a desk and you say, a desk is a desk, that is not a definition, that is an identity. So if you say, what is a woman? And somebody says, a woman is somebody who feels like a woman, they still have not defined the root term at issue. That's not, again, how that works. So this brings us to gender. According to our pseudo-medical activists, gender identity is completely separate from sex, completely disconnected in every way from sex. The separation between gender and sex relies on a very simple fallacy, that gender is entirely and completely socially constructed and thus separate from biology. This Cartesian notion that you can be a woman in a man's body because your gender is separate from your sex is, again, not supportable at any level. Now, everyone understands that there are certain attributes in humanity that are considered more masculine and some that are considered more feminine. These distinctions appear across cultures. Some of that is undoubtedly biologically oriented. In fact, you can see some of these sex differences in behavior in the primate kingdom. Some is probably a social construction. But it is ridiculous to suggest that if a boy is effeminate, this is because he is actually a girl, or that if a girl is a tomboy, this is because she is actually a boy. But this is exactly what gender theorists now argue. The origin of the gender identity movement actually begins with a charlatan at Johns Hopkins in the 1960s. There are twin boys who were born, and after a botched circumcision destroyed one boy's penis, that boy was raised as a girl. By the time he was a teenager, the boy felt extraordinary discomfort, and his parents told him the truth, which is that he was a biological boy who'd been mutilated. Both twins ended up killing themselves in their mid-30s. That did not stop the founder of this particular school of study, the guy who actually said that they should do this to the twin, his name was John Money, from founding the John Hopkins Gender Identity Clinic in 1965. His theory was that children could identify as members of the opposite sex and that radical surgery was the proper solution. That inside, deep down in the cockles of their heart, these kids were actually members of the opposite sex and surgeries would make their body align with their feelings. Money claimed, quote, the gender identity gate is open at birth for a normal child, no less than for one born with unfinished sex organs. All children could be boy or girl, even if they were born a boy or a girl. This remained a fringe, bizarre theory, except that the deconstructionist movement in the United States began glomming onto it. So you had radical feminists like Judith Butler who began arguing that all gender was socially constructed, and therefore all inequalities in society between men and women were also socially constructed. So if you just got rid of the social construction, men and women would perform the same in every area of life. Now, this was kind of self-defeating, because if gender is socially constructed, how can you even identify as a member of the opposite gender? Think about it. If gender is a completely social construct, then how, as a man, can you identify as a woman when the notion of what it is to be a woman is a social construct? If gender is a meaningless social construct created by society, Why should it matter more than biological sex, which after all is grounded in reality? Why would you have to change your physical body in order to deal with a social construct? In fact, we've been told over and over and over in life that this is something you should not do, right? That if there are socially constructed systems of racism, for example, you shouldn't try to darken or lighten your skin in order to deal with the social construct. You should instead deny the social construct. Instead, what we have are people denying biological reality on behalf of a social construct. Furthermore, most obviously, if the argument is that feeling like a woman or a man makes you a woman or a man, why exactly would that be so? Rachel Dolezal felt like a black woman. She was not, in fact, a black woman. She was a white woman. They say that age is just a number, but if a 16-year-old identifies as a 40-year-old, nobody's going to let them buy whiskey. And if you identify as a wolf, I still can't kill you during hunting season. Now, the reality is that gender dysphoria is a serious and tragic disorder. Though suffering from gender dysphoria, which in its non-politicized definition means the persistent belief that you are a member of the opposite sex, they have a tragically high suicidal ideation and depression rate. That suicidal ideation rate remains tragically high after surgical and hormonal treatment. And the mental health problems associated with gender dysphoria remain extremely damaging, even in particularly, except, that's inarticulate. Okay, two quick things. One, fuck you is not an argument. And two, no thanks, I'm not interested. The mental health problems associated with gender dysphoria remain extremely damaging, even in particularly accepting societies. But suffering from a mental disorder does not mean that your underlying sex has actually changed, any more than believing that you're Napoleon Bonaparte makes you Napoleon Bonaparte, or, less flippantly, believing you are too fat when you are actually underweight, as anorexics do, makes you actually too fat. Transgender activists make an objective claim about reality based on subjective internal feelings. That is not sustainable. What's more, transgender activists demand that you go along with all of this and that you abandon reason, biology, physics, because we have to go back in time. If you now consider yourself a transgender person, we have to pretend you were never a member of your original biological sex. Elliot Page was always Elliot Page, not Ellen Page. One of the stars of Juno, it turns out, is a man who was pregnant at the time, except that's anybody who saw the movie knows that that was Ellen Page, not Elliot Page. But if you mention Elliot Page and the original name of Elliot Page, Ellen Page, this is dead naming, and you're supposed to pretend that Elliot Page was actually the star of Juno. Now, here's the thing. Gender dysphoria is extremely rare by the statistics. According to the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual, 5th edition, which is the gold standard for mental health care, those who had received a diagnosis of gender identity disorder or transsexualism and were seeking hormone treatment and or surgery represented just 0.005 to 0.01014% for males and 0.002 to 0.003% for females. But transgender identification is now rising extraordinarily rapidly. One 2021 study now suggests that the rate of transgender identification among urban youth in the United States may be 9 in 100. So we went from individuals pretend to hundreds of thousands of people to 9 in 100, according to particular studies. And of course, Gallup polls now show that where members of the older generation, people born before 1945, identify as LGBTQ at a rate of 0.8%, people who were born between 1997 and 2003 identify as LGBTQ at 20.8%, which is an extraordinarily high number. Now, this is not because a vast number of more people are suffering from gender dysphoria. It's because transgenderism and the belief that you are a member of the opposite sex is a social contagion. It is pressed forward by the media, by parents who are engaged in Munchausen by proxy, and by teens who imitate one another on social media. According to Abigail Schreier, in Britain in 2018, there was a 4,400% rise over the previous decade in teenage girls seeking gender treatments. Between 2016 and 2017, the number of gender reassignment surgeries for girls in the United States quadrupled. 70% of those who were seeking such surgeries were female. All this despite the fact that for decades, all diagnoses of gender dysphoria skewed in male to female direction, not female to male direction. One reason for this is something called rapid onset gender dysphoria. One study shows 86.7% of young people with rapid onset gender dysphoria also had friends who came out as transgender recently, meaning that social contagion is a massive factor here. But Unfortunately, the LGBTQ plus advocacy movement lies. They say the best protection for children who experience any form of gender confusion, no matter how early, is quote-unquote gender-affirming health care. In fact, the White House Press Secretary Jen Psaki announced this week that the Department of Justice would seek to prosecute states that prevented minors from receiving hormone treatments that can have permanent long-term effects and surgeries that permanently mutilate and sterilize these minors, calling it gender-affirming healthcare, which is more accurately determined biological sex-denying healthcare. It is not gender-affirming, it is a denial of biological sex. This is actually awful and damaging for kids. In reality, somewhere between 70 and 90% of childhood gender dysphoria resolves, meaning without any treatment whatsoever, it goes away. People go on and they don't believe they're a member of the opposite sex anymore. Given the fact that many people who now identify as transgender do not actually have gender dysphoria and don't claim that they have gender dysphoria, that number would be a lot higher, along with societal celebration and social media incentivization pushing this stuff along. Yet, in clinical trials, 100% of kids put on puberty blockers, then moved on to cross-sex hormones. In other words, when you force people into gender-affirming healthcare, what they actually do is it cements them in place rather than allowing them the possibility of growing out of it, as the vast majority of kids with gender dysphoria actually do. What is more, puberty blockers, according to the latest studies, have no statistically significant impact on mental health improvement for teens. The media just lie about it. So, for example, this month we saw a study from the University of Washington championed as proof that puberty blockers, quote unquote, work. But as Jesse Single points out, quote, the kids in the study arrived with what appeared to be alarmingly high rates of mental health problems. Many of them went on blockers and hormones. They exited the study with what appeared to be alarmingly high rates of mental health problems. This, of course, should not be a major shock. Propagandists routinely twist their data to avoid the obvious implications of their own data. The Trevor Project, for example, it's an advocacy group for transgender radicalism. They put out a study published in the Journal of Adolescent Health last year. It was touted by the media as proof, undeniable proof, that hormones were the answer, lowering rates of depression and suicidality among transgender and non-binary youth. The problem is the study is gamed. It compares two groups of people who received quote-unquote gender-affirming healthcare with people who wanted but did not receive gender-affirming healthcare. It entirely ignored two other control groups, those who did not want to receive gender-affirming healthcare and those who used to identify as requiring this stuff and no longer do. By the way, even among those aged 13 to 24 who wanted to and received so-called gender-affirming healthcare, 44% seriously considered suicide, 15% had actually attempted suicide, far higher than the rates in the general population by like an order of magnitude. Men cannot become women, women cannot become men, and the societal insistence from the top levels of our cultural arbiters that you mirror this lie is damaging. It is damaging to the truth, it is damaging to children, it is spreading a social contagion that is highly damaging to the most vulnerable members of our society, and it doesn't solve the underlying problems of people who actually suffer from gender dysphoria. Lies like this need to be called out, and they need to be fought back against, because the simple fact of the matter is if we can't agree on a shared reality in which basic statements like men are men and women are women can be said, then we share nothing at all. Thanks so much. Happy to take your questions.
Thank you so much, Ben. We're now moving on. Thank you so much, Ben. We're now moving on to the Q&A portion of the event. If you have a question, please make your way to my colleague here and line up behind her. Keep your question brief. We want to ask one question so we have time for as many as possible. Thank you. We have our first question now.
Hey, Ben. Hello, Ben. I'm a student here at UNCG.
Sorry, it's a little difficult to hear you. Sorry, yeah. Go ahead.
So my question was, why is monogamy as opposed to like polyamory or promiscuity the best option?
I'm sorry, say one more time.
Why is monogamy as opposed to promiscuity or polyamory the best option?
Because all societies are built on the healthy bearing and rearing of children. And the most valuable form of the bearing and rearing of child is mother and father in the home with the biological child that they have sired.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Yeah, hey, Ben. My name's Nikita. Thank you for coming. Thank you to everyone who made this possible. I had a question real quick about regarding abortion. When a woman knows that she's having an abortion and she knows that she's killing a human being, because we've seen videos of them bragging and saying, you know, oh, I'm killing my baby, I don't care. What standard do we refer to? If we don't refer to the Bible as the standard of, you know, right and wrong, what standard do we refer to in telling her that she's wrong when she admittedly knows she's murdering a child?
Well, I mean, if somebody knows that they are killing a child and they actually acknowledge that, this is not what I think most people do when they have abortions. Mm-hmm. I think they've been largely indoctrinated by our society and our media into believing that they're aborting something completely meaningless, a cluster of cells. They've been told that they're doing an act of good on their own behalf and that there is no countervailing value on the other side. Mm-hmm. So you're talking about the extraordinarily rare situation in which people are shouting their abortions because they know actively, this is a human being and I'm killing it. I mean, honestly, it doesn't require the Bible to understand the sort of general note that you're not supposed to kill your own kids. And so if somebody fully acknowledges that they are killing their own kid, I don't think you have to cite to the Bible to say it is wrong to kill your own children. This exists across every culture, so far as I'm aware, that killing people generally is not a good thing. Now, I shouldn't say every culture, because there are ancient societies, Sparta used to leave enfeebled children out to die in the winter and that sort of thing. But the kind of general concept, which is it's bad to kill innocent babies, I think holds true for the vast majority of societies. I don't think you actually need to cite to the Bible to go there.
All right. Hey, thanks.
Hey, Ben. My name is Sydney. It's good to meet you. Good to meet you. All right. Here's what I believe. Democrats and Republicans use black people and minorities as pawns for their political gain. Joe Biden, for one, is a complete racist and has done nothing for my community. Kamala Harris is a complete traitor and added to the incarceration rates of my people and has the audacity to represent us. Do you believe in the notion that parties, Democrat and Republican, are using us for their own selfish gain to move their party forward?
So I think that pretty much all political parties are built to use people for their own particular selfish gains in order to gain office. I mean, this is what political parties do. I don't think that's unique to any one political party. Okay. I will say that if a party does not serve the interests of the population it purports to serve, then the use becomes more obvious and more venal, more corrupt, and more terrible. I think that the general way that parties ought to be appealing to people is not on the basis of race. This is why I think that the Democratic Party's appeal to black Americans is far uglier than the Republican Party's appeal to black Americans. I don't think that you see the Republican Party appealing to, quote unquote, the black community as qua the black community, or saying, as Joe Biden once suggested, that if you don't vote Democrat, you're not black.
Exactly.
Right? That's the sort of statement you really only see in the Democratic Party. So it is sort of one-sided that way. But yes, I mean, I think that if you are going to deal with people in a rational fashion in politics, you have to deal with them on the one-to-one individual level rather than treating them as parts of groups, per se.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thanks.
Hello, my name is Stephen Benelli, and I have just a question about, in general, we have your preconceptions about gender and all that. So I'm wondering, I find it really unsatisfying when you talk about gender and being like male or female, as just reducing it down to chromosomes. Do you feel as if there's like a really important like social aspect to like being a man, you know, that just doesn't simply get like transcribed by your chromosomes? Do you think that there's like something more to like humans than just like their
sexes? There are masculine qualities that attach to biological manhood that have been generalized. They don't necessarily apply to everyone, because you can have effeminate men who don't necessarily fit those categories. If you were to ask me what makes a good man or a useful man, I would give you a description that would include social categories like protecting your family, going out and earning, making sure that you build institutions in your society. Right?
So nothing that has to do with chromosomes.
But
nothing like chromosomes.
But in the end, if you have to ask for a definition of male or female, what you're talking about is the most irreducible form of this is the biology, which is why you can uncover a body from 30,000 years ago and a scientist can tell you whether it is a male or a female without ever knowing how that person lived.
All right. Thank you.
Ben, how you doing, man? I've been watching you on YouTube for years, so it's kind of surreal standing up here on the mic, but you're the man. Hey, so quick question. Do you feel like it's reaching like a tipping point as far as all these things we hear about? It gets more and more radical. Do you feel like it's reaching a tipping point where, as far as the media and stuff, their representation of this will change?
Yes. I mean, I don't think the media's representation of it will change. I think more Americans will just turn away from the media. So I think that you are seeing this with regard to, for example, the Florida Parental Rights and Education Bill, which is not, in fact, called the Don't Say Gay Bill, nor does it say anything about being gay in the bill, if you read the text of the bill. Right? What that bill says is that you are not allowed to indoctrinate kids K through 3 on sexual orientation or gender identity, which I don't care how radical you are. And I know gay parents who object to the idea that kids are meant to be innocent and they are meant to be protected. And when you stop protecting kids in favor of indoctrinating them so that you can have them mirror back to you your own political priorities and then make you feel good about yourself, this means that you're a selfish asshole. Okay, the reality is that if you're not protecting kids and you're instead using kids as tools for your own sick political agenda because you wish for approval in your private life from a 5-year-old, there's something wrong with you.
And I
think that people who are pushing this politically and in the media are not seeing the blowback that's coming. Honestly, I've never seen anything like it. I've never seen a political party and a media literally create an interest group out of parents. That's insane politics. It's insane. There's 63.1 million people in the United States who have a child in their home under the age of 18. To turn those people into a voter block is the greatest form of political insanity I've ever seen in my life. And yet the left seems confident in doing it. It's crazy.
Yep. Thanks.
Hey there, Ben. My name is Hugo Obregon. I just want to know, why do you think trans people are killing themselves because they're trans and not because, like, the way society treats them in the same way, like, the suicide rates of gay people go down as they're more accepted?
So the suicide rates of gay people actually have gone down some, but not entirely. Unfortunately, the suicidal ideation rate among gay people remains very high. It's highly associated with depression and suicidality, even in very accepting areas like, for example, San Francisco. The suicidal ideation rate is still significantly higher than the non-LGBT community. Transgender suicidality rates, there's not been any meaningful study that I can see that suggests that socioeconomic status, for example, impacts this, or that mere acceptance changes the extraordinarily high suicidal ideation rates. In fact, there was a study from the Trevor Project that recently came out, and it looked at social acceptance in families, and what it found is that 40% of trans kids, or minors who identify as transgender, are still experiencing suicidal ideation, which suggests to me that this is not merely a question of people are being mean to people who are trans. Our society, as an overall affect, is much more accepting of people who consider themselves trans than it was, say, 10 years ago. The suicidal ideation rates remain precisely the same. They have not changed overall.
Hello, sir. My name is Corbin. And I wanted to ask, so you were comparing the LGBTQ community to animals that are not humans. And I wanted to ask specifically...
No, I was comparing the argument of transgender people to be a thing they are not to people who also claim to be a thing they are not. That was the argument.
So I wanted to ask, if we're a developed society and our mind thinks differently than other animals, shouldn't we have the ability to go to a higher level where we are able to overcome the societal constructs that have been created and create something in which each individual is happy instead of thinking that we have to go over the social construct?
So I don't think biology is a social construct, and I think the greatest way of finding unhappiness in your life is to go to direct war with biological reality. This is a very stupid thing. If you walk off the 99th store of a building saying we've developed in our society to the point where really we should be able to transcend the laws of physics, about halfway down, you're going to realize this is a very bad idea. And if you do the same thing with biology, saying that biology no longer matters because we, in our Cartesian minds, are able to have ourselves soar above the realities of biology, this is a very bad way of living your life that's going to end with an enormous amount of misery. Biology is a reality. Denying reality is not going to make people's lives better. It's going to make it markedly worse.
But it's not biology, it's gender. Gender is not biology.
Biology and gender are interconnected, and to pretend that they are not is to ignore all available data. I mean, this notion that gender is some sort of free-floating idea out there and that there's no actual differences between men and women except for the fact that men are slightly larger and can carry heavier burdens. And even, by the way, there are members of the more radical LGBT community who even deny that. They suggest that even, which is why they're suggesting that, for example, biological males should be able to play sports with biological females if the men say they are women. To deny that male and female are categories that also have inborn behavioral differences attendant upon them is to ignore the impact of biology. And again, that exists not just in humans. This exists in virtually every mammalian species.
Well, these animals don't have...
Okay.
These animals do not have the ability to think like that, but we do. I don't understand.
No human being, no biological being has the ability to so completely transcend its own biology that you can magically change your biology by suggesting that you are a member of a complete opposite sex. Maybe one day we'll discover an alien creature that can do this, or a non-mammal that can do this or something. But the basic idea that through thought alone you can transcend all biological limits, again, this is just a recipe for a disaster, and especially when you're indoctrinating small kids who are innately vulnerable and frankly stupid. I have three of them. When you're indoctrinating small kids in these dumb ideas and confusing them, you're really damaging them.
Then with children, shouldn't we guide them?
Hello, my name is Palumi. Just noticing there are a lot of like red herrings I feel like that are being thrown or whatever. And I mean, whatever, I understand you're up there. You have to say whatever you have to say to all these people.
Well, I don't have to say anything. It's a free country. But why don't you go to the argument?
No, of course. And I support the free country. And that's actually exactly what I'm going to be talking about. Oh, sorry.
Yeah.
All right, that's exactly what I'm going to be talking about. If you support like free rights, I don't understand how you can't. Like what YF did, they're in their free right to do that. However, trans people are in their free right to live however they want to live and feel comfortable in however way they want to live. So I just don't understand how you have this free right idea. How do you not realize that your ideas are imploding on themselves?
Okay, so
that you're going to eat, your ideas are going to eat themselves.
No, they're not, because the
radical conservatism is going to eat itself. How do you not see that?
I'm wondering where you're getting the right to be comfortable in all your ideas. Are you defining the right to express your ideas as the right to be comfortable in all your ideas or the right to have all your ideas affirmed? You're here denying my ideas. That's fine. That's good.
Yeah.
I appreciate that.
Of course.
Okay, well, if somebody makes an objective claim about reality that is untrue, you have no right for me to affirm your untrue claim about objective reality. That right does not exist. It has never existed, nor should it ever exist.
Fair enough.
Hey, Ben, I'm Will. I have a religious question for you. So I figure you've probably heard this before, but C.S. Lewis makes the argument that because of Jesus' exclusive claims that he is either a liar that intentionally led people astray, a lunatic that believed that he was the Son of God and he wasn't, or he's Lord. Would you put him in one of those categories, or would you put him in another separate category?
So, I mean, because I'm a Jew, I'm just going to, I mean, look, I'm a Jew, so obviously for those who are not particularly versed in Judaism, the reason we're not Christians is because we don't believe that Jesus was the Messiah or a physical iteration of God. Mm-hmm. Right? So the answer that is typically given here is there is a fourth option, which is the belief in Judaism that the Gospels are unverifiable and that they don't relate Jesus' own self-perception. So I've said this before, that it's not that Jesus was a liar or that he was a lunatic. It's that, you know, in Judaism, we don't actually believe that a lot of the claims that Jesus makes in the Gospels jibe well with what Jews even at the time would have claimed, right? Which is actually the claim that Christianity makes. Christianity also makes the claim that Jesus is making transformative claims that would have existed outside of Judaism. So obviously, if you're a Jew and you see those claims made, you're like, well, no Jew would make that sort of claim. That's a weird claim to make. Christians are like, right, no Jew would have made that sort of claim because he's God. Right, so the option from within Judaism is to suggest that Jesus was actually a historical figure who was saying a lot of things that Jews would agree with, because if you read a lot of the New Testament, it, as you would expect, mimics a lot of the things in the Old Testament, and that he was actually a political figure and that the Romans crucified him because he was a political figure who was attempting to lead a rebellion against their tyranny. That's the Jewish historical claim about Jesus. Now, again, I'm not saying that Christians agree with that claim. They don't. This is why I'm Jewish. This is why you're Christian. Nor am I saying that if you're Christian, you shouldn't go to church. You absolutely 100% should. I'm trying to encourage more Christians to go back to church. I think that the future of the country is deeply reliant on the reinstitution of trust in the church as an institution.
Thanks, Ben.
Hello, my name is Quentin Merritt. I'm a mathematician and a physicist here, a double major, and I also just won the most prestigious award in the country to pursue research at any institution I want, the National Science Foundation Graduate Research Fellowship. So I think I'm pretty, you know, qualified to say that most of what you're saying is based on, like, old data. But my question to you, and so I want you all to, like, realize that.
Last month, but sure.
Like, for example, gender identity disorder, that's the DSM-4, bro. We use the DSM-5 now for psychologists to be able to talk about...
I literally cited the DSM-5 in the speech, and it's called gender dysphoria, which is the term that I use throughout the speech, not gender identity disorder.
You sound like a bozo, bro. And you get no pussy, and you can't even make your wife wet, bro, so what's good?
So, number one, let me just say, the nice thing about... Having several small children, I don't feel the necessity to have my masculinity challenged.
If we're using a Western colonial idea of gender, then why should it apply? If we're using, because the gender binary is a Western colonial is a Western colonialist framework of gender.
You're right. Men and women don't exist in any other culture.
No. You're think about Native American. Nailed it. Third gender people. I'm not saying that. Third gender people exist in Native American societies, Western African societies, like Southern Native American societies, like Mexico. So in other places that are not white dominated,
and they
like
are
the United
incorrect.
States or Europe. And so you're
saying
white.
Biologically
so non-white
incorrect.
People. I'm a mathematician and a physicist. You cannot
so
tell
what
me.
So I have a question.
And also, you're not a biologist.
So I have a question.
I'm 20.
As a mathematician and a physicist, what in the hell do you know about human biology?
And you got your law degree from Harvard. What do you know about biology? You got your law degree from Harvard.
And frankly, I would ask another question. If your logic is so flawed as a mathematician and a physicist, I would suggest that whichever institution gave you an award, revoke it immediately.
Hi, Ben. My name is Emily. One of the biggest issues I see in America is the increasing division or polarization between both conservatives and liberals. What's destroying America, in my opinion, is not simply just the so-called woke left or the so-called fascist and conspiracy-filled radical right. I see an issue arising from both sides, where one party does something and the other party complains and reacts in hostility. I believe most of it comes from how the media on both sides portrays the other party. I also believe the increase in the consumption of social media plays a role as well. Nowadays, you just go on Twitter and it's Trump did this or Biden said that. Bottom line is, all I see is anger and hatred towards each other who disagree with each other. How can we get anything done if this anger continues? I mean, we see it up here, clearly. How will the government on a federal level get anything done? This makes me concerned for the future of America. And I know there's no legislation we can pass that just says, you know, hey, we can all get along and be
right.
friends. But, you know, there's got to be some type of strategy we
right.
can use
so,
to mitigate this
okay,
division.
Okay, so a few things. One, you know, I think the clarity in politics is useful. So clarity, as my friend Dennis Prager has suggested, clarity before agreement, I think is sometimes useful. Where we disagree, it's important to see why we disagree and what those disagreements are. Because sometimes it turns out that disagreements are actually smaller than you thought they were when you first sat down with the person, which is why conversations are really necessary and good. It's why I sit down with people on the other side of the aisle, I would say probably more than nearly any other major mm-hmm. political figure, certainly on the right. I don't see a lot of it happening on the left either. You know, as far as social media, it obviously exacerbates divisions. You can get echo chambers for sure. It's also true that without social media, you don't have an echo chamber. You just have one sort of media hegemony from one particular side of the aisle. So I'm very grateful that social media exists so that you can rebut some of those points. Listen, I'd be a hypocrite to say I don't appreciate social media. It's made me wealthy and famous. But I also think that what you're really talking about is the death of institutions. And institutions are not built nationally, they're built locally. So the great discovery of the founders and really of Montesquieu before them is that if you wish to build social institutions, that has to start at the very local level. It starts with your family, and then it starts with your local community, your church, your religious community. And then as you abstract up the scale, you need to have less in common with people. So, you know, when I lived in California, I had to have more in common with my neighbors than I did with somebody who lived in New York. Now that I live in Florida, which is a much redder state, I have to have more in common with my Florida neighbors than Florida has to have with California. But that requires an agreement that at the top level of government, people are essentially going to leave each other alone. What it means is that you can do more in the local context because you agree more with your neighbors, right? Inside your local community. I'll just give an example, say tax policy. So inside my religious community, we all give a lot of charity. Okay, we have a lot of charity. I know a lot of churches tithe, a lot of synagogues tithe as well. And that's very comfortable and fine because you know all of your neighbors and the people to whom you are tithing. As you abstract up the scale, the attempt to make somebody give money to a person they've never met far across the country who doesn't share their priorities is going to run into a few obstacles. And so what you need is a recognition that local governance is best governance. They're going to have more agreement in social fabric at the local level. And one of the big problems with social media is it's nationalized every single issue. Every single issue becomes a national issue. Something happened in your local community, we're supposed to care if a school board in Indiana takes a book off its reading list, right? This is something we're supposed to care deeply about. When you nationalize every issue, it makes everybody feel like they're in each other's business, even when you've never met this person and this exists several thousand miles away. So this is why I've said before, on a governmental level, I'm very conservative at a local level, and as you abstract up the scale, I'm more and more libertarian because you need a more libertarian federal government because you can't have it cramming down standards that a huge number of people disagree with and hope to maintain a social fabric.
Thank you.
Hey, Ben. My name is Dasan, and I just have a brief question for you. How much are you being paid to speak here today?
I will have to check with my assistant. My normal speaker fee is really, really high. I think I gave a discount on this one.
What's that?
Really high?
Ballpark.
Well, I blush to say. I feel like it's not humble.
I'm curious. I'm very curious.
Well, you're very curious what my normal speaker's fee is?
Yes.
I'm not charging my normal speaker's fee to Young America's Foundation for this particular speech, but if you contact my assistant, Kelly,
I want to hear it from you.
What was that?
I want to hear it from you. First of all, it's an honor to see you in person.
If you want me to come to your house and speak to your friends and family, I'm going to charge you $100,000.
All right, sounds
good. That's how much I'm going to cut.
Thank you.
I'm not charging $100,000 here today. But, by the way, if I were and I could get it, I 100% take it.
My name is Nathan, and I would like to ask you, sir, why are trans rights your main argument for freedom of speech when there are so many pressing issues that matter more?
Because the main argument against freedom of speech that is being made in today's America is that you ought to be deplatformed, banned from social media, maybe ostracized socially, and maybe targeted governmentally if you refuse to go along with the basic biological lie that a male is a female or a female can be a male. It is a large-scale attack on freedom of speech. This is a large-scale defense of freedom of speech on the same point.
Thank you.
Hey, Ben. Huge fan. My name's Trey. Oh, sorry. No, you're good. You're good. So my question was, generally speaking, people 35 and younger don't care much anymore to hold on to history and its lessons that we learn from it. How do you think we can make the lessons of history enticing again and to not lose its lessons?
So I think that to make history lessons enticing, you really have to immerse people in what people thought at the time. And this is something we're very hesitant to do. I think one of the reasons that we've sort of bled out of history a little bit is because people are very hesitant to try and identify with people inside history because, after all, we're all better people than the people in history. We're all smarter and better. I mean, this is what we've mostly learned from Nicole Hannah-Jones and company. Congratulations to UNC, by the way, on not having Nicole Hannah-Jones as a tenured member of their faculty in general. But one of the major factors, when you learn history and you really study it, you have to try and put yourself in the shoes of the people who are living the history. And what that means is sometimes dealing with and grappling with really ugly arguments of the past, really bad moral standards of the past, and trying to think, why would somebody have thought this at the time, and try to steel man a bunch of bad arguments, you can understand why those arguments are wrong. People have a tough time doing that because they immediately feel as though if I even spend 1 minute in the head of a person whose ideals I don't like, this makes me that person and therefore I'm very, very bad. And the problem with this, of course, is that to study history and to prevent it, you have to understand human beings are inherently sinful, and 110 years from now, people are going to look back at a bunch of the thoughts that we have, and they're going to be judging us for how terrible we are at the time. And so if you wish to foreclose the worst in human nature, if you wish to stop yourself from being the worst version of you, you have to spend some time thinking about some of the worst thoughts human have ever had and say, why did people agree with this? Why were people willing to go along with this? That's the best way to learn and not fall into the same traps.
Right. That makes sense. Thank you.
How you doing, Ben? My name is Eric Zappone. I actually drove in with a couple of my friends from Elon University. Thank you for coming. So my question is simple. With multiple Wall Street investment banks recently warning of a recession, what's your opinion on America's monetary policy and Biden's chance of re-election heading into 2023?
So, I mean, America's monetary policy has been far too loose for far too long. It was rooted in the basic notion that inflation had basically been a dead letter since the early 80s, since Paul Volcker ramped up the interest rates in the early 80s. And for a while, that was true. I mean, one of the things conservatives always argued was in 2007, 2008, there was going to be a massive inflationary wave, and it didn't happen. And this time, you had some conservatives saying there will be a massive inflationary wave. And you had people on the left saying, no, don't worry. You can just keep borrowing and spending no matter how much money. Just create the fake money on a computer somewhere, and it'll be totally fine. And, of course, that is not what has happened. I think that the inflationary policies that have been pursued by the Fed, it's going to be very difficult to get away from those inflationary policies, which are the product of quantitative easing really over the course of the last decade and a half. It's going to be hard to do that without rapidly ramping up interest rates to the point where we tip over into a recession, which is, I think, what most economists are saying right now. I think that combined with superheated spending policy of the Biden administration, which spent $7 trillion last year. Yeah. I mean, in a time when you didn't need to make that spending, there was an argument that you needed to do some of that spending when the pandemic was sort of at its height. Joe Biden entered office, there was a working vaccine, and by April, a huge number of people who were the most vulnerable, the majority of the people who were most vulnerable, people like my parents, about 65, virtually all of those people had the opportunity to get vaccinated, at which point we should have gotten back to work. Instead, we blew trillions of dollars more into the economy. So it seems to me that the inflationary pressures are going to continue for the next, at least until the end of the year, is what most economists are now saying. I think that's going to have some long-term impacts. But as I've been saying, since the beginning of the inflationary spiral, I worry a lot less about the inflation than I do about the economic stagnation that follows heavy regulation and even higher taxes, which is what Joe Biden is pushing. So I'm not so worried about inflation being a persistent 5-10-year problem. I'm very, very worried about economic stagnation being a 10-20-30-year problem from here on out. By the way, you know who else was worried about this? Was Joe Biden. Even when Joe Biden came into office, Biden was not expecting inflation rates to be like this, but he was suggesting that after Build Back Better, this giant spending boondoggle that he didn't get away with, that the growth rates 3-4 years from now would be 1.5%, 1.6%, 1.7%. Those are bad growth rates, and he was expecting that. So the prospect of economic stagnation scares me. I think Joe Biden, I mean, if he runs in 2024, if they somehow strap him to a gurney and prop him upright and roll him from train stop to train stop, having him mumble in non-English, I think that he has a poor chance of re-election. I don't see anybody else on the Democrats bench. Kamala Harris is the worst politician I have ever personally seen. Kamala Harris makes Hillary Clinton look like the apex of human charm. And they have nobody else on the bench. I mean, Pete Buttigieg's record is abysmal. He's done a terrible... I mean, when you can go missing from your job for 2 full months and no one notices, this is a good indicator that you're not fantastic at your job. So they have a really, really thin bench. The biggest mistake, in my opinion, that Republicans can make, frankly, is to renominate President Trump in 2024. Yeah, I think that's a mistake. The reason I say that's a mistake, he could beat Biden. I'm not saying he can't beat Biden. He could. The problem is that he is an established figure, and whoever the election is a referendum on loses. In 2016, the referendum was on Hillary Clinton. She lost. In 2020, the election was a referendum on Donald Trump. He lost. If he runs again in 2024 and he's the nominee, then it's a question. Is the election a referendum on Biden or is it a referendum on Trump? If you get some new blood in there, I'd say my favorite governor, Ron DeSantis.
DeSantis. Yeah.
Governor DeSantis knows how to fight, he knows where to fight, and he doesn't have anything remotely like the baggage that Trump had, mainly because, I mean, Trump had to drag like a 727 filled with baggage everywhere he went. You don't have that with DeSantis. So I think the Republicans I think they're going to clean up in November. I think they have a really good shot at 2024 as long as they don't make the mistake, I think, again, he could win. If he's the nominee, I'll support him. I don't think that, I don't think he's the best possible nominee for the Republicans at this point.
Thank you for that.
Hey, Ben, my name's Jack St. Pierre from Elon, North Carolina. I'm here with the Sig Pi Boys. So my question for you is, what's up with the Batman movie, man? I saw your review.
Yeah,
you
know? Okay, so quick poll of the room. Who saw the Batman? Yeah, a lot of people. Okay, and quick show of hands, who liked the Batman? Okay, who didn't like the Batman? Okay, yeah, me and all seven of you. Okay, so if you want to see my full 20-minute review of why I didn't like the Batman, it's available on YouTube. I had to cut it down to 20 minutes. Originally, it was 4 hours long. I think the Batman fundamentally misunderstands the character of Batman and is a referendum on why Batman is bad to fight criminality and really why he needs to become Superman and lead suffering people onto roofs of buildings and medevac them. That's really not Batman's job. So that's sort of my key criticism of the film. Also, Batman, it turns out, is a really bad detective because the Riddler just gives him the entire plot of the movie all the way through the movie and then randomly decides... Okay, I'm not going to stop there. I don't want to spoil it for those of you who haven't seen it. Okay, fine.
Thank you, Ben.
Hi, Ben. My name is Phoenix Winters, and I had a question about parenting styles. I was wondering what you thought would be a more difficult time, because I know that you care a lot about you know, our children and our people, you know, our young people.
Mostly I care about my kids, yes.
Okay, but largely you care about the next generation also growing up with conservative values. So I'm wondering what you think conservative parents should do. Like, what would be more difficult, in your opinion, to raise, a gay son or a thought daughter?
A gay son or a
thought daughter.
Or a...
T-H-O-T?
I'm too old for this.
Okay, all right. Yeah. A promiscuous daughter.
I mean, what? I'm just going to go no.
Well, I appreciate it.
And move on with my life.
Hey, man.
Sometimes, you know, you tell people to ask new questions. Sometimes they do. It's weird.
Sorry. Okay. What's up, man?
Howdy.
My name is Mason, and I wanted to ask, you mentioned earlier it cost you $100,000 to get you to the house. What about your sister?
Well, you'll have to ask for her speaker's fee. She's a very talented woman who's in demand. Also, she has a brand new baby, so it's going to be hard to get her.
Congratulations on the baby.
Hi, Ben. My name's Ember. In 2021, you said that the potential rise of global temperatures by 4 degrees Celsius due to climate change is, quote, not an emergency, and even made fun of top scientists for calling climate change a climate emergency. A new study by the Journal of Natural Science says that if by the end of the century, climate change will total up to 83 million deaths because of climate-related causes.
Yeah, they're wrong. Sorry, go ahead, but continue, but I'll explain why. Go ahead.
I'm wondering, Ben, why you believe that climate change is not an emergency.
Okay, because they're wrong. So now here's I didn't let you get to the question mark. The reason that they are wrong is because all of these studies are done in the absence of mitigating measures. So as I've said before, when I talk about climate change, when you're talking about climate change, there are a couple of things human beings can do. And by the way, I accept IPCC estimates. They range from sort of the mild, like 1.5 degrees Celsius, all the way up to the not very mild, like 4 degrees Celsius, again, over the course of the century. And because there is this range, the more extreme versions of this, the 4 degrees Celsius, whenever you read the IPCC reports, which I have, when you read those reports, they say in them that they have very low confidence that some of the more catastrophic sort of predictions are going to occur. They will say low to moderate confidence. The less catastrophic predictions, they'll say more like high confidence or fair high confidence, that kind of stuff. Okay, here is the thing. When people suggest that there is not going to be any sort of mitigation measures, this is wrong, or adaptation. So there's two ways you can deal with it. One is mitigation, which is we all stop driving cars, we stop using electricity, we don't have kids anymore, right? We really cut down on our carbon usage in ways that are catastrophic to the world economy. And what it really mostly does is it says to people in the developing world, hey, you're screwed. Because those are the people who really need carbon-based emissions. It's very easy for those of us who live in extraordinarily prosperous societies to say, you know what, I'm cutting down my carbon emissions a little bit because we live in very prosperous societies. Carbon-based energy is by far the most efficient form of energy on the planet. And it's worthwhile to notice that people who are living in developing or undeveloped countries, those people are still, in large part, burning things like dung for fuel, which is not only carbon intensive, but also a horrifying way to live. And telling those people you can't use carbon-based energy is a mistake. In order for us to take the mitigation measures that would be necessary in order to dramatically lower the trajectory of global climate change, you'd have to get China to sign on, which they will not. You'd have to get India to sign on, which they will not. Those are the two largest carbon-based emitters on planet Earth. And we live in a geopolitical world in which a carbon emission from China counts the same as a carbon emission from the United States, which says, again, this doesn't mean there's nothing we can do. It means what we ought to be doing is the thing that will prevent the 83 million deaths, which is why I'm very confident it will prevent the 83 million deaths, adaptation. This means, for example, that we build seawalls. The simple fact of the matter is that New Orleans exists below sea level. When the seawalls, when the levees were breached because the levees were poorly built, it killed 10,000 people. When the levees, last time around, this last year, there's a major hurricane, it swept directly through the exact same area, and pretty much no one was killed. The reason being, the levees were much better built. When you're looking at coastal low-lying areas, seawalls have been built in places in Miami, in places in Seattle. Geoengineering, which is a methodology that's being explored largely in some of the northern European countries for actually changing the climate itself by, for example, shooting particular types of material into the air. You know, these sorts of solutions are things we should be pursuing. They're a lot easier to do because technology is a lot easier to do than anything remotely approaching a global carbon tax, which will, number one, be unsuccessful, and two, will not mitigate the effects on the climate nearly as much as you're talking about. Human beings are great at adaptation, and we suck at mitigation. And as I've said before and been mocked for it, the simple fact of the matter is over the course of the next 100 years, when you see all these maps and it's like this area will be flooded and all those people will be dead. No, because they won't be living there. Because as it turns out, when the tide rises, people move inland. This is what has been happening throughout human history. Not a huge number of people were killed, presumably, when the land bridge between Russia and Alaska that from which Sarah Palin could see, right? When that land bridge ended up being covered up in water, there weren't tens of thousands of people who died in that because it took thousands of years for that to be covered up by water. Slow-moving crises are not crises. They're problems, not emergencies.
All right, we have time for one last question.
Hello, Ben. My name is John. I'm a big fan. My question is, do you think that it's appropriate that the right generally promotes Christianity in the state when America was founded on separation of church and state?
So I don't think that the right does generally promote Christianity in the state, considering that the Supreme Court has forbidden everything up to and including prayer in schools, which is a ridiculous anti-constitutional decision. Also worthwhile noting that it depends on what you're talking about as the state. You're talking about the federal government, you're talking about local governments. Okay, because the fact is that the First Amendment to the Constitution applies specifically to Congress, and up until the beginning of the 19th century, there were a bunch of states in the United States, believe it or not, that actually did have official religions. Okay, there were official religions in states in the United States. So the idea that it's anti-American to do that is wrong. Now, do I want there to be an official religion of the state of Florida or an official religion of the United States? No. But do I want a robust and healthy institution of Christianity in the United States that the state does not infringe upon and does not destroy? Absolutely. It's my view that religion can only truly be built ground up. It's built by local communities, by church-going people, by synagogue-going people, people who make social ties with one another, but religion can be crushed top down. And so my goal is to prevent the state from crushing religion top down so religion can flourish bottom up. That's the first step. And I think right now the biggest problem we have is not the state promoting religion, it's the state actively discouraging and quashing religion from the top levels up to and including the idea that you are now in certain public schools forced to indoctrinate your kids, in particular not only anti-religious ideologies, but anti-science ideologies as we've discussed here today.
Thank you so much.
Hey, thank you so much. I really appreciate it. Thanks for coming out. And thanks for all your hard work.